Hello and welcome to the Team BVB podcast for all your weekly racing game rambles. I'm Martin, and joining me as ever is Kevin.
Hi guys.
Alan.
Hello viewers.
And Ed.
Hi everyone.
As always, if you enjoyed the podcast, do give us a like and subscribe. It really helps support what we do. And this week we're giving away a code for Grand Prix Rockin' Racing, not Rockin' Racing Off-Road, just to make that clear. So do check out the website for more details on that. So it's the news we've all been waiting for, frankly. Gran Turismo Sport finally has a release date. It's coming out on April 20th, so that's just 1 month away. You guys don't believe me, do you?
No.
Allegedly. No.
Yeah, so the news comes from a Finnish retailing website, so take that as you will, I think what we'll say on that one. Could it really come out that soon with no notice? I highly doubt it, frankly.
It's got to have its big E3 moment, hasn't it, where they show an amazing video and then 10 new tracks and 1,000 new cars and, you know, suddenly we're all drooling for it.
It just doesn't make any sense to bring it out at that time. It's got to be the kind of game that comes out towards the end.
It's a quiet period in April for racing games. One of the few quiet periods this year. It won't collide with Forza and Need for Speed and everything else.
No, well, I suppose.
Perfect time to release a game. But no, there's a lot involved in launching a game like this, you know, in terms of the PR marketing build up, the pre-sales in the stores and stuff like that. It's a big operation.
This is a first party Sony title, and it's not gonna a budget just for the marketing alone.
Yeah, I mean they'll want to get the pre-orders, because of course they refunded all the pre-orders last year, so they'll want to get all of that back on track. So it's a big operation, but you never know. You know, they're so far behind.
Stranger things have happened.
Yep.
It's usually the kind of thing that we expect from a much smaller game, where it's like we find out about it and then it's like, oh yeah, the release date's in 2 weeks and there's like hardly any marketing behind it. It's definitely not the kind of deal that you expect from the likes of Gran Turismo.
No, exactly. Although stranger things have happened, like for example...
That rally?
I was going to say a tag hire partnership with Polyphony.
Let's not go there. Although they are releasing an official...
The smartwatch coming. You can get your very own Gran Turismo Tag Hire smartwatch. Yes. How about that?
Yes.
Oh, I love the press release. It says they're currently building a watch together with Kazunori.
Of course they are.
Nice. It's nice. It's funny though. Very expensive watch.
I wonder if there's going to be two versions, like a standard and premium watch.
Yeah, the deluxe version.
Or premium and premium.
Super premium.
That's funny though how the reception for GT Sports kind of made a bit of a U-turn this week. Before there was just so much hate for it, and now it seems that everyone's raving about it because of all the videos that come out from the beta. Although they do look very nice, I have to admit.
Gorgeous.
What can we say? It looks like real life in some shots. You would easily mistake it for real life.
I mean, the darker lighting stuff looks incredible. I was so surprised. I mean, I've been moaning about GT Sport recently about, you know, how good can it look? I want to see the features. But honestly, I didn't expect visuals on this level. But then, you know...
It's Gran Turismo, this happens.
Yeah, Gran Turismo never disappoints visually, does it, often? So it's all about the content now. We know they've got the graphics. They're showing it off. It looks great. So now it's all about getting the content right, and if they can do that, well, it could be a force to be reckoned with. But we just wonder, you know, does it have enough features to sort of go up against the likes of Project Cars 2 and potentially...
Yeah, is it more than just a pretty face?
Yeah. I think one area which does really worry me is damage, because we're not seeing damage still. I mean, is this going to be a game that has no damage again? Because it's looking that way, isn't it?
Probably.
I mean... It looks impressive. It looks more like now we expected it to look last year. So in that sense, it's looking better. I'm still concerned about the environments. I think that my big issue last year wasn't the cars, it was the environments. And the Tokyo circuit was lifeless. And every time we see clips of that circuit, it doesn't seem like it's improved in any way. So yes, the cars look amazing, and the lighting and the brake lights and stuff like that, really nice effects. But when you're driving, doesn't look as good as the replays. The replays do look a lot better than the actual driving experience, which still looks a little bit clinical. And yeah, just at the moment, I'm still waiting to see the finished game. I mean, you know, we've not tried the beta yet, but once I've played the beta, I'll understand a bit more about the whole experience, where it's strong and where it's weak. But replay wise, it's very nice. I admittedly, they still use sort of video gamey hover cams, and I would prefer it if they use more actual TV cameras. I think hover cams are nice if you want the hover cam option, but it's also nice to have official TV camera option, which would be great on places like the Nürburgring, really, where you had long views down straights and stuff like that. So but no, the GIFs look amazing. I mean, you've seen some of those on the website. As I say, the lighting is fantastic. I'm going to move on while we're talking about onto audio. I don't know if any of you guys have been listening to the audio. They have made audio improvements.
I was going to say, actually, yeah, it did sound a lot better. Yeah. The engine sounded a bit more gritty.
They sound better, but there is one problem, is that they whine a lot. They're very whiny engines, and I was listening to the real cars and listening to the sort of whine and thinking, oh, you're not actually hearing the raw sort of glug of the engine, especially in a V8 or something. You're hearing this whine, but you're not hearing the engine properly at all in car. So the audio is not there yet. They've got better audio, but it's not still not there yet. Mm. Outside the cars sound better in the replay mode than they do in car in game. Mm. Sometimes they even have a bit more of that engine note in there than actually when you go in the car, you can't hear the engine hardly at all. So you've got that issue. Also on the replay cam, they have this strange echo, and it's a hard walled echo. It's like a simulated hard walled vibration.
Sounds like it's in an auditorium or something.
That's right. Yeah. It simulates. Because I've got this amp which simulates it, and it simulates hard walls. That's what you're hearing. It's like an empty room with hard walls. That's what it simulates. Which is not, you know, they've got no concept of how the car should actually sound from distance. So in terms of their audio, the audio is better, but it's still not market leading audio. I mean, when you compare it to Assetto Corsa, Assetto Corsa is way better. Yeah. So,
It's just the usual case of Gran Turismo improving incrementally with each game, but still lagging very far behind the competition.
Yeah, I wonder if that echo is like a placeholder for a sort of more dynamic environmental sound, like you get with cars racing around. You know, you get that sort of Doppler effect and whatever. So, who knows?
I hope so. I mean, there is improvement being made, but I mean, this is all. I think the reason why I'm critical is because it's taken 4 years to get this far. Yeah. So, after 4 years, you've got engines that miss core sounds out. You've got replays that don't sound right, and we haven't even heard the tunnels yet. I mean, the tunnels sounded awful in the original build. They just may as well have not been going through a tunnel. So
we're never going to have anything positive to say about Gran Turismo Sport.
At this rate, we won't. No, I mean, I'm going to play the beta. I mean, I am bored of seeing Brands Hatch as well, if I'm honest. I mean, I love Brands Hatch, but I'm bored of seeing it in Gran Turismo Sport. We did that a year ago. Show us some new tracks. You know, I thought the beta was hopefully going to be on something new. But instead, it's going to be on brand. So, yeah, really nice replay stuff, really nice photo modes. But let's wait and see what the rest of the driving is like. I mean, I look forward to playing it and seeing how it develops. Nobody's really talking about it. You know, I've looked online here and there. Not a great deal of people are really going into any detail in terms of what they're feeling or, you know, their feelings on the game.
And it's taken them so long for any kind of development that people have become a bit deflated about it, and they've just left it too long.
Mm. At the same time, though, it is the first time in months and months I've seen anyone say anything remotely positive about it. So it's getting a better reception than it did 6 months ago, that's for sure. But
yeah, I mean, graphics, you know, go a long way to selling games.
That's it.
Just based off the graphical, you know, the strength of the graphics, you know, this game is going to sell because it just looks amazing. Everything else to most people is secondary, like for the main sort of mass market, if you like. And obviously the more hardcore racers like us will be more interested in the features, but you know, as a sheer selling tool, those graphics look incredible. And if it can look good in the VR as well, then you know, they've got a real sort of powerhouse there to, in graphics terms, just to sell a product.
It's a game for Sony to be able to say, look what the PS4 can do, or rather what the PS4 Pro can do.
Yeah, exactly. It's all this time later. Yeah, exactly. It's just come too late though, like Ed was saying, you know, the interest is gone because we've heard about this game for many, many years. You know, okay, it's had incremental graphical updates. This one is particularly massive, I must say. This one's very impressive. But even so, we're not sure when it's coming. You know, we're coming up to the end of March in 2017 now. This beta was supposed to come out 2016, and you know, the game's even supposed to come out before then originally. So it's dragging on so long, as it always does with Gran Turismo. And you know, they said with Gran Turismo 7 it won't be so long, and it's just as bad as, you know, GT5 all those years ago. And it's like, as a GT fan, it's really struggle to love Polyphony. It's very hard to get behind them.
Because a GT fan, I agree.
Yeah, it is.
You do wonder what year Polyphony think it is.
It's like they work in their own time, isn't it? Their own sort of space-time going on there in their headquarters in Tokyo. But
I don't know.
Yeah, it's like good things will come to those who wait, but it's just a shame we have to wait years more than, say, the Forza fans have to. I mean, we're all big fans of Forza anyway, but, you know, I guess we came on board with Gran Turismo because it's an older series. We love it. But it's just hard to really sort of get behind GT Sport at the moment.
Sony needs to change their clock from 2010 to 2017, I think.
Well, I think they need to change their clock from, you know, 99, frankly. I think that Kazunori, he's, you know, he made Moto2 and Grand Prix, which is disowned, and he's made Moto2 GP2, which is disowned, and Omega Boost. If you ask him, he doesn't. It's like video games don't exist. He's all about cars now.
It's like asking George Lucas about the Star Wars Holiday Special.
Yes, I guess in a way. Or maybe not. I don't know. Maybe asking about the original Star Wars films. He doesn't want to talk about them. He just wants to talk about his prequels. I think that, you know, he's made a lot of money out of the originals. Then he went off and did his racing, his Nürburgring races and all the rest of it. And it's like, you know, it's almost like he doesn't devote his time or energy to the game. It's almost like the team have just sat on their laurel. As far as I could see, the team have really not done any work for a couple of years, frankly. Yeah. I mean, there was next to nothing done a couple of years ago. A couple of tracks, a couple of cars, not looking very good. What have you been doing for 5 years? And it seems to me that as a team, they're not well organized. They're not well organized. And that's why you end up with these situations. So, I mean, let's see.
Are we saying that Kazunori is like the George Lucas of racing game developers?
He is, but maybe he's in more ways than one. Maybe he's lost it. You know, maybe he thinks something's good enough when it's not now. And there's other people that have been brought in to bring Gran Turismo up to the level it's expected. I mean, he's a name for Polyphony and for, you know, for the brand. But, you know, what if he's not able to bring the game the way forward, the way people want? Some of the things he was saying in a press conference last year, I was sitting there in bemusement a lot of the time, you know, thinking, really? I mean, am I the only person in this room who thinks this is a great looking, who thinks this is disappointing, sorry? Everyone thinks this is great.
I wonder if he's on the same page with all the developers. You can imagine other developers like arguing with him. And then not overruling it. Again, a bit like George Lucas.
I do imagine that, yeah. If you argue with it, I mean, if you argue with George, he'd fire you. So that's why nobody argued with him, so the film came out.
George, Jar Jar is a bad idea. Don't do that. No, it's staying.
You're fired. That's kind of how it worked with him. And it's probably like that in some of these games companies. You know, you just can't say anything against anyone because they are who they are. So, no, I really look forward to seeing how it's looking so much better than it was a year ago. The cars look incredible.
There is progress.
You know, there is progress. It's still a way to go, but it's looking like the game we're expecting it to look like a year ago. Put it that way.
Yeah. And as usual, it's just that one, you know, a few years behind the competition.
And, you know, I mean, it's we're never really going to know about this race until we see Forza 7 and Project Cars 2 near completion, because I think that's when we're going to be able to compare. I mean, the VV Awards next year, wow, we're going to have some discussion.
She will be crowned the winner. All money's on Project Cars 2, I think.
You know, I think well, it's difficult to say. You know, never turn 10. I wouldn't bet against them doing something very special. You know, when you think of what they were getting at an Xbox One with Forza 6, it was very impressive. So, you know, if they can do that, what can they do with four times the power on the Scorpio almost? Yeah, we'll have to wait and see. Yeah.
Hopefully some good damage modelling.
Yes.
I think they get restricted quite a lot by the manufacturers, though, when it comes to that.
Yeah, there is a lot of manufacturer restriction. There's no doubt about that.
Yeah. So, I mean, as we said, then Gran Turismo, for example, isn't exactly known for its damage modelling. Then again, neither is Flat Out 4, I'm disappointed to say. So we've all been playing Flat Out 4, which came out recently, so I thought we'd just steer the conversation to that for a bit. Kevin, you said in our Flat Out team chat you're eager to play it online.
Yep.
Have you tried it online since then?
I have.
Didn't live up to expectations.
Well, the problem I have, the main problem I have with it is the numbers are low.
Yes.
And because of that, it loses its intensity. You know, it's not quite as intense as a single player, because single player you have, you know, four grids of cars crashed into each other, doing all your bits and pieces. Whereas online, if you've only got three or four players taking part, you know, it's not half as good an experience. And
I should point out as well, actually, that the online count
the
only
numbers. Yeah, the online count's only eight.
Yeah.
Yeah. And you wonder, well, okay, there's a lot of environmental damage and that, but I guess when you look at it, I don't know, the graphics are quite dated. I mean, what's holding them back?
If anything, for online.
Yeah, yeah.
I think the game, because, you know, this is a game that, you know, prides itself on chaos and destruction. And like you said, when you're just racing against three or four other opponents, it just isn't there. The intensity is it's completely diminished. Also, I noticed too, I don't think there's any online rankings. Did you notice anything like that?
No, what there is very similar to Tabletop Racing World Tour. Once you get online, you get a number of points for position in the previous events, and that actually disappears as you disconnect, so you don't keep any sort of rank, any point system, so it just resets.
So there's no real incentive to keep coming back then, really, online, for people that enjoy that sort of thing.
I just, you know, you just hope that the online would be good, and therefore, you know, it'd be an enjoyable game to come back to. And it just, I was left underwhelmed by it, unfortunately.
I think what would have possibly helped as well in situations where there's only, you know, three or four players, even just an option to fill out to fill in all the empty slots with bots.
Oh, maybe? Absolutely, that would have made a world of difference, really. But unfortunately, it's not in there, and you think, well, why is it not in there? A game like this needs four grids of cars. You know, even if it's just eight cars, well, let's fill it in, like you say, with AI cars. You know, a lot of games do that, and, you know, often better as a result. And this is one game which really would have benefited from that, I feel.
All the cars unlocked as well online, which I found a bit strange.
Yeah, I was surprised actually when I saw that. It was like, goodness me. So this is what the car looks like that's been unlocked for so long, and I couldn't unlock because they're not telling me how to unlock it. You know, it's you win all the races, but you still got cars you need to unlock, and you think, well,
that's one of my big frustrations with that.
Tell
game.
Me how to unlock this car, and then I'll do it. You know.
Yeah, I have to say, I really, really hate saying this because I really wanted to like it, but the more I play Flat Out 4, the less I've enjoyed it.
Oh, really? Oh, wow.
Yeah, I'm afraid. The career is just such a grind to get through sometimes, and then there's not that many tracks, so they end up repeating. Right. You don't have enough money to buy anything. As you said, the cars don't get unlocked. So, I mean, you spend so much time in the kind of entry-level cars with no clue how to unlock any of the better cars.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Often, you know, they give you the unlock conditions, but they're not doing so in this game. So you're just left to your own devices. How do you unlock these cars? You know, they say you win events to unlock cars. Well, I've won all the Derby events, and I've still got two Derby cars that are locked.
I've got gold in every single Derby event, and this I've unlocked about three cars out of nine. That's another gripe, actually. Yeah, the
supposed 27 cars, which is actually nine cars with a bit of reskinning going on.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah.
It's every class, you get literally the same car in every class, just with different skin or some armor or stuff like that on it.
Different states of disrepair.
Yeah, I mean, that is really cheating the car selection, isn't it, I think?
I get the impression that they got this game out pretty quickly. You know, that they were using the earlier games as a base in terms of vehicles and tracks. You know, they're asking people to vote on what sort of tracks they wanted included. So it really does feel like it doesn't feel like a true sequel, does it?
I don't know what it is, to be honest. That's the trouble.
It's almost like a spin-off, isn't it, really?
It doesn't have its own identity. No. It's better than that game, obviously. But
yes. I found the game grew on me the more I played it. Because I could find a vehicle that I could upgrade and actually able to drive over the bumps. Whereas you take a stock car and, you know, like we said, the railway bumps previously, you know, so frustrating. And
yeah, those damn railway tracks made me restart so many races.
They are horrendous, aren't they?
Ironically, they railroad you into the wrong direction.
Yes, yeah. It's not
But
good.
It's like we was chatting earlier, Martin, and we said about the physics. Once you get airborne, the cars go very light and they're very prone to spinning, like sort of exaggeration.
I don't understand the car physics at all, because on one hand, the cars do feel quite heavy sometimes. You know, they understeer. And it's quite satisfying, actually, sometimes to catch the slides and know when to use the handbrakes. They got that all fine.
Yeah.
And then suddenly, it's almost as if they're made out of cardboard when you hit a tree. it's strange.
Like, sometimes when you go up to a corner where you're like, okay, I should probably brake for this corner or slow down or try and slide it around a corner, and you just spin on like the spot.
Yeah.
You just sort of turn in and all of a sudden you're doing donuts.
Yeah.
I was playing in the classic class, and I've been stuck with this off-roader, one of the first vehicles, and it's so prone to spinning out. I'm just desperate to get another vehicle, but I can't.
And they're so expensive, aren't they? Yeah. The higher tier you go, I mean, my goodness, they really rack up in credits. So, like I said before, you know, it pays just to enter a race with a higher durability and strength car and just go smashing it into as many cars as you possibly can. You know, you can get 10,000 plus credits, and it's a bit of a, you know, you're sort of farming credits in a way to afford these faster.
Must provide you can unlock such a vehicle.
Yeah, well, exactly. It's like we said before, you know, you really have to invest like 5 hours into the game just to get your head around it. And that's not good enough for today's mass market appeal, is it? People are not going to be able to have the patience to do that. So
you can easily spend 5 hours just doing one race.
Yeah.
Just for the amount of times you have to restart it.
Mm.
Alan, have you had many time to play it lately?
Not play a great deal. No, I've done a few races, but I just I didn't get into it. And I think one of the things that I was really hoping to get into was the various flat out modes.
Oh, yes.
You know, and I just found them to be just infuriating. Honestly, I just didn't feel like I was chatting to somebody the other day. We were playing it, you know, and I said it would have been better if it was like PGA Tour golf, you know, where you had like a power bar and then another power bar. And it'd be great if there was something like that where you could actually arc your shots and stuff, and you felt like you felt like there was some kind of element where you had control. I've just found that so often, I just feel that I have such limited control over the guy that as soon as his body's on the way there, I mean, golf, I mean, Kevin got a hole in one. My goodness me, the amount of times my body has just skipped across holes, and I'm like, what is that all about? In pressure gaming moments, that I thought, no, you know, so it's a shame they're not online, those modes, are they?
No.
And I think that's the thing, you know, it's only been good when I've had somebody pop around to compete against, but when I'm just on my own, I get bored very quickly with it, and I think
it's good in party mode, I'll say that much, in multiplayer, but there's no split screen for the races,
no, so it's. I just think the game's a bit rough around the edges. It seems to me like it needs another year's development in a way.
It needs some damage modelling as well.
Some damage modelling as well, yeah. Needs a bit more of that. Yeah, definitely. So it's not as fluid. It's just the physics are not as fluid and as natural as the original games. Things seem to fall apart and work in a way that seemed real. Picked up on is the different behavior of the car at different times and stuff like that. It's like the physics is inconsistent, and in flat out it's all about physics. That's what makes it so fun, you know, and that's what I'm finding just sort of canned in a way, you know, is the way it's been sort of handled. Mm.
So yeah, disappointing, unfortunately.
I think also a main thing with Flat Out that I find frustrating is it almost feels like there's no background to it. There's something that we often define in my work. We build software for what we do at work. And every project that we do has to have background and objectives. Because if you don't have that at the start, then you can build a software solution and it can complete the functions that you want it to complete. But if there's no reason, then some things get lost in translation. So without a proper background and objectives to something, it doesn't make sense in the long run. I think that's something that's happened with Flat Out 4, is that you get thrown into the career and there's no reason for doing anything. So it sort of feels hollow. It just feels like that's why the career probably feels more like a grind at times, because you're just completing races just for the sake of it. There's no reason for doing anything. I think that's one of the main things that didn't get me hooked on it right at the beginning. Mm. Something that it really lacks.
Yeah, it's just the progression system's just all over the place. I think that's half the problem with the career. It's definitely not a game you can just pick up and play, which was one of the main appeals of the original Flat Out games. But yeah, I mean, I think my main opinion really of it is it just lacks an identity. It doesn't quite know what it wants to be. You know, it tries to go back to the roots of the first couple of games, but it just doesn't do enough to improve on them. You know, four games in, yes, it's a different developer, but with the name Flat Out 4, you expect it to at least be on par or better than the last one. Actually, that one doesn't exist in all that. Ultimate Carnage, which came out 10 years ago, but it's not. So.
No,
we'll see what happens with the series in the future. I mean, they might do a sequel. It might be another, WRC 5 to WRC 6, where there was quite a big improvement in that one year.
It seems like they need new technology to really sort of progress the series.
Yeah, exactly.
Which they might not have, or maybe just the resources. You know, it's time, I should say.
Yeah, I'd say wait for Wreckfest if you're looking for a destruction-based racing game. Whenever they decide to. Release it from early access.
Exactly. I know. One day, Wreckfest will come out.
Yeah. If anything like Flat Out, it'll just come out of nowhere.
Yeah. Which is a shame, because it really needs a bigger, more controlled build-up than that, you know.
Yeah. But, you know, I was amazed when they said it was coming out in March. Like last month.
Yeah. Well, there's been no information at all.
No, I thought the project was dead.
Yeah.
If anything. Yeah.
It's certainly been through phases of ups and downs, I'll say that. But
yeah, it's a weird one. But I just hope it's not reflective of the quality in some of the other games coming out this year from Killerton, like obviously Isle of Man TT.
Yes, it is a worry, isn't it? I mean, are they juggling too much like Milestone had possibly done before in the past?
Mm.
We do wonder if these titles will ultimately suffer if they are sort of taking on too much. Yeah. And who knows what else they've got up their sleeves, you know, it's...
Well, you must be worried about Test Drive Unlimited 3 now, Kevin.
If they're developing it, yes, I am a little bit, because I love that series so much. It's so dear to my heart, you know.
Oh, you see, this is what happened to me with Flat Out.
Oh, no. I can understand your pain. But I hope I don't have to get there, you know, and suffer too much. But, you know, with Test Drive Unlimited 3, it's got to be all about the driving. You know, you've got to have your open roads, you know, your sort of satisfying winding roads, a little bit of off-road thrown in. You've got to have your garages, you've got to have showrooms, you've got to have your houses. You know, there's not an awful lot to it. As long as the driving is satisfying, as long as there's, you know, you can wind down your windows, beep your horns, you know, take your convertible down, maybe indicators thrown in. You know, you have to feel like you're driving this real car. You know, it has to give you that experience, whether... You know, it looks phenomenally realistic or not. You know, it doesn't really matter, as long as you get the feeling of driving a car in a sort of game world. Even, you know, it's going to be satisfying. But they nail that aspect of driving, then you know it should all be good. But we'll see.
Yeah, don't hold your breath, I'd say, after that. But who knows? Who knows? We'll have to wait and see. Right, so I guess we should catch up a bit on some more racing game news. On to Project Cars 2 then. We had the announcement recently of the Circuit of the Americas. Obviously, don't forget, Project Cars 2 will have the largest collection of tracks in a racing game on console. Is that a track you're very fond of, Alan?
Can't stand it. No.
it's one of the worst
Tilk designed circuits. It's a Agreed. Mismatch of three different circuits that have been put together. It has no flow. I don't like a lot of the corners on it, and I don't find it at all fun to drive. The final sector in particular, I think, is a horrible sector. I just don't like it. And I don't see why people do like it. I mean, it's, you know, there's just not much to it, really. The high-speed section, it lacks any kind of identity because it's all these other circuits combined. You can say, oh, that's a bit of that circuit, and that's a bit of that circuit, and, you know, it just doesn't work. So, it's in everything now. Everybody's going for it, but, you know.
Like the Flashlight 4 of racetracks, and what you said there.
It is, probably is. Yeah, and I can't stand racing it. I'm not very good at it. I don't like it. Well, I'm not good at it because I don't play it very much. I always dodge it. I barely ever play it unless I have to. But I don't enjoy it that much.
Does that mean you hate it more than the Nürburgring?
Yes. Mm. Yeah. I mean, I'm not a Nürburgring guy, but I have nothing against the Nürburgring. It's just, yeah. I'm just not into it. But the, no, KOTOR, I just dislike it. For me, it's the worst circuit.
Fair enough.
Can we move on?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'll be better.
I mean, don't get me wrong, though. It's good it's in Project Cars 2, and it's also good because in Project Cars 2 now, it increases the roster of circuits they have for Formula 1. As well, so yeah. Quite a few Formula One circuits developing there, bubbling away. So that's good to see.
Yeah, it's all about choice, though, isn't it? Project Cars,
all about choice. You know, a lot of people like it. There's a lot of series there. Mm. It's great to have it included. That's the main thing.
Yeah, I mean, to me, that is one of the best selling points of the series.
Yeah,
unlike most games where there's too many cars and not enough tracks, it's the opposite case in Project Cars.
Well, no, that's the thing. In a way, you can't have the opposite because, you know, when you've got, you know, WEC cars, right? So you've got World Endurance Championship cars, and then, like I say, a lot of games will have, you know, four courses, maybe just two courses in the game that suit those cars. You know, at least in this, they're going to have most of the WEC series is going to be available in the game. You can run a full WEC season. You know, and depending on how many British circuits are in there, you'll be able to run a touring car season. Woo-hoo. So, you know, let's hope we get a few more British circuits in there. An IndyCar will be in there in full, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
It's going to be good.
Mm. Of course, last week as well, we had the reveal of those Nissan racing cars for Project Cars 2. This week, it's a set of courses turn with the reveal of the Mazda 787B. Have you been onto that one, Ed?
I have indeed. I managed to get a bit of time on that just before we started the podcast. Mm-hmm. And literally it took me 5 minutes and I realised, okay, these are the cars that we had as mods. Mm-hmm. I think they were fairly early on, really, in the Seto Corsa lifespan. I think the 787B was one of the earlier mods. The MX-5 is the pure MX-5 for anyone that's familiar with it. So it's essentially a Mark 1 MX-5, 1.8-litre engine. I was really hoping to see if they did like a Stage 1 version with, I mean, just an LSD. If you just put an LSD in one, that would make it infinitely more fun. But they are very good cars. The 787B especially is a lot of fun. So and they're free, so can't really complain.
787B, I mean, that's a car that sounds incredible. How does it sound in a Seto Corsa?
It's pretty good, actually, especially the idle as well. You know, it's great when you first boot up an in-game with that, and it sort of fades in. You can hear this blah, 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 blah. It's like, yes.
Nice. This is what we want in Gran Turismo, you know. This is...
Yeah, take note, polyphony.
Yes.
Yeah, definitely.
For the love of God. At least they're still supporting us, of course. I think lots of people were worried that with this year being so packed with new racing titles, instead of course, it would just kind of fall under the radar a bit. But
it seems like ages since these ones I'm pretty sure they announced these two cars ages and ages ago.
I think they did, yeah.
The Jetpack came out to start with or something.
Yeah. It's interesting because once again, it's on the PC first, and we don't know when it's coming to consoles. You know, they recently spoke about this new partnership, which will allow, you know, more funding, more resources, and yet here we are once again.
That's true.
You know, it's the same situation, unfortunately.
I will just say, actually, love the Mazda 787B. It's a great sounding car, classic car. Of course, it's the one Johnny Herbert was driving years ago as well, and somebody crashed it at Goodwood last year, I'll point out, and did a lot of damage to it when it went out there. Oh, God, it was horrible to see. I played this car a lot, actually, in Gran Turismo 3. It was in Gran Turismo 3, and it was just my favourite car in Gran Turismo 3, the amount of races I did in it. And then I also raced it when I added it to Forza Motorsport 4. And again, it was a nice rendition. It sounded good. It's always a great looking, sounding car. For me, it's the definition of a Le Mans car in so many ways. I don't know. I mean, you've played it, obviously, Ed. It should feel intense to drive, but in the replays, it should scream in the replays as well. Though, I mean, this is a very loud, brutally loud car, but wonderful engine note.
Yeah, that is pretty intense when you're in the car. It reacts very skittishly to the Nürburgring speed bumps. That's where I did my test, which, as you can imagine, is probably quite realistic, actually, because the Nürburgring speed bumps are almost like driving up a wall. Yeah. And in a car that's like 2 centimeters off the ground, it's obviously going to... I think you guys were laughing at me when I hit a speed bump and it spun me out very quickly and I did a little... that's the sort of experience I'm having with the 787B, but it's great. But like I said, anyone that's had the mod early on in the game's life cycle, and also the pure MX-5 mod, you'd be very familiar with these cars. It's basically the same. So
MX-5, go.
I was going to say, the 787B, of course, has been in most Gran Turismo games, so that'd be an interesting sound comparison.
Mm. It will be.
Mm. Be interesting to see how it appears. What we expect it will be in GT Sport. Be a nice one to appear in Project Cars as well. Project Cars. Mm. I mean, I just love that car, so I want it in every game. That's one of those I'd like to see. Mm. Now, I was just going to say the MX-5, good old MX-5. I actually don't fit into an MX-5. I can't physically fit into the driving seat at all of an MX-5. I remember a friend of mine who used to drive one, and when we went out, he used to put the roof down just because my head was higher than the windscreen. So it would literally be freezing for me. I'd have to sort of duck down when we were driving. You know, it's like a scene with Hightower out of Police Academy. I just want to take the whole seat out, basically.
Yeah.
I could comfortably drive one without the seat.
Nice.
It's a nice little car.
Yeah.
Nice little addition. Should be fun to drive, actually. Mm. You know, and approachable as well. For newcomers,
definitely is, actually. But funnily enough, not long after the original mod for it came out, I did an event at my sister's primary school for their summer, I think it was like their summer fair or something, and I took my PC down there and took the steering wheel, and the kids were paying 50p to have a go around a track in the MX-5, and it was perfect for that, because it doesn't have the ability, but it's got an open diff and it's hardly any power, and you just stick the traction control on and they find it really easy to get around a track and have some fun. It's a great little car for that.
Nice.
Both iconic cars for very different reasons, aren't they? So it's good to see both of those in the Assetto Corsa. Great cars.
Yeah, some nice free additions there, has to be said.
Yeah,
indeed.
Yeah.
So we also have the news then that Dirt 4 will have a team management system. With this, you get sponsorship deals and you can purchase new and used cars with race winnings and stuff like that. It's being compared, though, to the original Race Driver Grid game, which I thought was interesting. Does this sort of system really belong in a new game, do we think?
I haven't read enough into it to know yet, but I think any additional depth is a good thing.
Mm.
You know, as long as it's done properly. If it's too light and there's not enough depth to it, then it's just a fad. But if it's got a bit of actual depth that affects the gameplay, then it's always a worthy addition.
Based on what we've seen so far from Dirt 4, it'll probably be somewhere in between.
Mm. Yeah, I mean, reading this, it very much sounds like WRC2 by Milestone, when they added these sort of different sponsorship bits and you can buy various team members, mechanics and whatnot. So it might just be one of those things they bolt on just to add a little bit more content to perhaps a game that might be lacking in content, possibly.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, there was a very basic team management system, Dirt Rally, if I remember, but it was just...
Yeah, I didn't care for that. It was just like...
You had like your team morale and stuff like that, but it had no real impact on the gameplay whatsoever.
It's the thing, though. Features aren't content, so... It's, I don't know, it's a hard sell for me.
Well, Dirt 4 in general.
Well, just bolting in other gimmicky features to try and entice me a bit more. I'd rather have...
Like your stage, you mean?
Yeah.
Well, they seem very set on your stage for the future titles. So it seems like they believe they've got an amazing piece of technology there and they're going to expand upon it for future titles. But... honestly, we need more stages, don't we? We need more environments and stuff. So,
no, exactly. Dirt Rally had one issue. It was the lack of content, and we're not so sure yet if Dirt 4 would really rectify that.
No, it's fallen into the same trap, hasn't it, really? I mean, otherwise, perhaps your stage wouldn't have existed if Dirt 4 had numerous countries, but who knows?
Mm, yeah, exactly. Not much else has really been revealed about Dirt 4 lately, has it?
No, it's all so quiet. I mean, we've got Res, the EGX Res show next week, and I was investigating to see if it would be there. It's not going to be there. And I'm very surprised. You know, here we have a show a couple of months before release, and been a great opportunity for first public hands-on, and they're not showing anything.
Res is more of an indie game showcase, isn't it?
It is, but, you know, even, I mean, you've got Micro Machines coming out as well in a few weeks' time, and that's not being shown either. So it would have been handy, I think, for Codemasters to have shown those two titles, but they're not showing much. I mean, they've shown almost nothing of both games, really. I mean, to us, we've seen nothing, you know. So,
yeah. Saying that, there's not many racing games on show this year in EGX Res. I've had a quick look, and
not found anything at all yet.
Thunder Fusion's going to be there.
Fast
IMX, and that's your lot.
Right.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, and some game called Jalopy, which has some driving in it.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, I know, yeah. I saw that. They did it's more of a car mechanic game than anything else.
Motorsport Manager's going to be there as well.
Yeah, and a cracking game. Our highest rated game of 2016, we'll point out. Motorsport Manager, they've been adding to it a lot as well, new cars and stuff like that. And they're having a free week this week, I believe. It's free.
Yeah, that's right.
And we put that up, but it's free for you guys to play. Ed, get downloading, have manage your way around a race. It's actually a very good game, you know. And my PC is awkwardly set up, my gaming PC. But if I had it set up better, it would be... Because I've got it set up with a steering wheel and a triple screen, everything, it's not really set up for management gaming. It's just set up for driving games. But it would be nice to
see the boat. My setup is solely around my rig.
Exactly. It's not practical for other things. So I will say they should release it on console, and perhaps they will.
Oh, I'd love to see that. Yeah.
Yeah. So Ajax Res is next week. We're going to be there at the show. Might be some surprises there. I quite enjoyed Res last year. It was the first time I ever went.
Yeah.
But it has a very different vibe to it to the main EGX show, and you don't have to wait for hours and hours just to play a game.
That's right. I really like Res. It's like Res is like the old EGX show 7, 8, 9 years ago.
Yeah.
EGX used to be like that. It was more intimate. They had these nice little areas for you to explore, sort of. I don't know, it felt like playing games in a cave, you know. It was really nice. You know, I really, really, you know, they just have rooms of beanbags and a couple of TVs in there, and there wouldn't be many people. You know, you could just go in there and get a game in 5 minutes on anything. Whereas now there's, you know, 3-hour queues just to see something, you know, or if you haven't pre-registered before the show, you might not play the game you want to play. I think I don't agree with that sort of thing. I think that's all nonsense. I think when you've paid to go into an event, you should just stand in a queue. That should be it. I don't think pre-registering queues, I think, is nonsense. But it's should be a nice little event. I love indie games. I think they are the lifeblood of the industry. Though I do hate it when I see this fad. Well, hate is a strong word, but I dislike it when I see this fad that. Like I saw an indie game the other day that was a two twin stick shoot 'em up, and I looked at it and I thought that's let's just say that's a bit rubbish, okay? and I looked at it and thought, because they've got this sort of blocky pixel retro style, as they call it.
What they think is retro,
What they think is retro. And I can say, when I looked at that, and I thought, do you know what? If the year was 1991, I would think that is as crap now as it looks then, okay? We wouldn't give it time of day. Graphics are rubbish. No parallax scrolling. Rubbish. And so many of these indie games now, for me, they're like Atari 2600 games that are adapted with more colors rather than Mega Drive and SNES. They're not. They don't have a true understanding of what makes good 2D graphics. And that's the thing I'm finding a bit frustrating about indie development right now. And, of course, young people growing up now who don't remember the games as they were don't know any different. They just see everything as retro. But it's not retro. It's rubbish. And that's,
I think there's a fine line, isn't there, between making a game look retro-inspired and just dated.
That's it. Well, yes. Yes and no. They're sort of making up their own version of what a retro game is. But, so a lot of this indie stuff is sort of looks very similar. But every now and again, you get something new and unusual and cool. And in the indie scene, you know, we have, obviously, R8 Games have got Formula Fusion. We've got Grip coming out this year, which I think Grip, for me, my most exciting ones, you know, you've got Formula Fusion, Grip, and Redout coming out this year on consoles. Yep. Grip is really looking good. I mean, there's more coming to Grip all the time. It's really coming along nicely. So, wait and see. I will get back on that soon for another spin.
Mm. Yeah, all these kind of retro-inspired titles is a bit of a trend lately. But speaking of retro, Daytona USA is now out on Xbox One.
Daytona!
And Alan's Xbox is broken just in time.
Just in time, my Xbox is broken today. Yeah, I managed to download it and it broke. So my Xbox One seems to have died, which is a bit of a pain. Daytona, though, good to see it back. You know, I mean, when Daytona came out 360, I loved it. And I was like, Sega, why don't you bring back all of your arcade games? This is the problem with live arcade right now. When live arcade started on Xbox 360, wonderful idea. All these old arcade machines and old games coming, brilliant. Now, when you play PS4, for example, you look at the arcade section, it's pretend retro, fake retro crap, as I like to call it, as I was just talking about. That's what you have when you look at a lot of these 2D games and arcade games that are available on PS4. But the Xbox 360 had real arcade games, conversions and stuff like that, and there were lots of titles in there that were excellent. And it was great to see Daytona, but where are the other racing games as well? Where's Sega Rally? You know, where's Virtua Racing? You know, or Scud Race? You know, or Daytona 2? Sega Rally, Sega Rally 2? You know, there's lots, you know, Ridge Racer. You know, why don't we see all these? I mean, there's literally hundreds of arcade machines that you should see available, you know, in HD running on these new systems. And I think then, these mini live arcade games would be so much more pleasurable to play rather than some of this indie stuff that's just being kicked out the door every week that nobody cares about.
It does make me wish the PS4 was backwards compatible, I must admit, because there are quite a few gems on the last gen that, you know, we've completely forgotten about.
Daytona, there you go. Daytona was available on the PS3 as well. And, of course, it's not available. So, there's a massive amount of titles. I mean, Sony, you know, have let their customers down in the way they've handled backward compatibility. When the PS2 came out, everybody said we want backward compatibility to PS1. And, you know, that was something which they sort of did. And then they've made excuses. Oh, the technology's changed. We can't do it. Oh, the technology's changed. We can't do it. And it's very disappointing, really, the way Sony have handled this every generation. And in a way, it's prevented me from buying many digital releases from Sony. I don't tend to buy digital releases from Sony because at least Microsoft are proving to me that they're really working backward compatibility. You know that all these games are going to work on your Scorpio, and there's a high chance that they'll do the same thing with their next format. Most of the games I'm buying now are on the PC because Steam just keeps on going.
Yeah, that's true.
So Steam is where I I'd probably buy more of these titles, but I don't trust Sony. I don't trust that my games will work for the next generation. You know, my PS4 may as well be a brick because most of the stuff I buy on it will be online only. And when they switch the online aspect off, well, nothing there then, is there? It's just a piece of history, you know, in 10 years. So, which is a shame. You know, at least with my old consoles that are offline, consoles, Mega Drive, SNES, whatever, you can always play those games as long as they work.
That's a very sad picture of the current games industry.
Sad, but true. I mean, for me, you know, when I got my Xbox One and, you know, originally, and it wasn't backwardly compatible, but I've still been playing my Xbox 360 more than any other console. So, you know, just because of the backward compatibility.
In 10 years' time, you won't be able to play The Crew. Probably.
I have to wait that long.
Well.
Yes.
Yeah. Anyone still playing it at that point? That'll be.
There's bound to be one. There's always one.
Yeah, these games like Test Drive Unlimited 2 is still going, still online.
Yeah, or the original Need for Speed Underground.
Yeah. Amazing. For
reasons unbeknown to me, but there we go. Right, I think that's it actually for this week's racing gaming news. So we should get on with the Q&A.
I will just finish. Daytona USA is awesome, and everybody should buy it. There we go. Carry on.
Oh, well. Yeah, saying that, it is one of the better ports of that game in the last, well, since the original arcade version.
It's the best port. It's the best port ever for it, yeah. Mm. Yeah.
Anyway, let's see what the fine people on the internet have to ask us this week. So, right, on Facebook, Barry Sharabati is asking, did you get the chance to try Gran Turismo Sport Beta, and how do you feel the physics were and the engine sounds? Although we haven't been on the beta yet because we're not American.
No, but we are hoping to get on the EU. Yes. Hopefully one of us, at the very least, will get onto the EU beta. So
yes, they are taking sign-ups at the moment, actually, for the EU beta, so you may want to jump on that if they're still up.
Yep.
So yeah, we can't really comment too much on that. Charlie Woodside says, what's happening with the official TT racing game? Is it just me, or do the developers not believe in promoting their game or building any kind of hype? Well, that's interesting, because that's exactly what we said about Flat Out 4. They announced it 2 years ago and then said nothing about it. So everyone thought it was dead. And then last month they said, oh, it's coming out in March.
The same's happening again, isn't it, with TT? So.
I'm getting that vibe, yeah.
I've actually spoken to some people in the know, and they say to me that that they are going to have some build-up. A lot of work's going into it, and it's looking good at the moment. But we'll just have to wait and see. But it's certainly a lot of work is going into it. We should see an announcement soon. There is an Isle of Man thing happening, and they're going to announce it soon, I think. I mean, I say they, I don't know for sure, but it's a common sense opportunity that you want to tie in the game with real life events if you can. So
yeah, like the WRC game series. Yeah, it does say to me as well, they probably didn't have that much confidence in Flat Out 4.
No, I don't think they did. No, I don't think they did. I think they you know, it was one of those that they just made it and had limited budget, limited time, and that was it. It's kind of come out, kicked out the door.
And then they charged full price for it.
Yeah.
Yeah, you can tell we're not a big fan of that game. Next question. Boris, I can't pronounce your last name, says, what is the funniest glitch or bug you have encountered? That's an interesting question.
I would say, for me, it's Project Cars. early in its lifetime, hitting invisible walls. So there's this one corner I got the apex on, and, you know, looking good. The line was good, and all of a sudden, bang! It's like I hit an invisible wall, and it was almost like Wreckfest style. My car was absolutely mangled, just out of nowhere. Like, it's as if it hit, you know, as if it was traveling at 1,000 miles per hour, and it went to 1,000 to zero in a millisecond. You know, it was just unbelievable. So for me, that stands out as a recent bug that really took my breath away.
Yeah, Project Cars was full of bugs. I remember my tires kept deflating for no reason at all. That was always fun. What bugs stand out to me? Oh, actually, going back a bit, the Driver series. Yes, we're on to Driver again. You may remember a game called Driver 3. Now, that was a glitchy game.
Yeah, that was a good game. I like that game.
I did and I didn't. Also, I called it Drift Freer because that's how they spelt it. one of the worst like marketing gimmicks ever for a game name. But yeah, that had all sorts of glitches. Like, for example, cars that would float in the air and drive around in circles.
I never had that happen to me. Oh, I remember that game. All I used to do on it was cause some big accident and then watch it from every angle in the replay mode.
Yeah, same here. I mean, I like the driving in that game, but it all fell apart as soon as you got out of the car. He looked like a constipated crab walking around the city.
I think in terms of glitches, some of the funniest ones I remember from the original Smuggler's Run game, you could do some glitchy things with the people that were running around when you run them over. So if you sort of like pin them under your car, sometimes they would like glitch out and like their head would stay under the car and the rest of their body would sort of stretch across the map and stuff.
Yeah, there was quite a lot of that stuff that used to go on.
The great thing about those glitches is that there was no patches back then, so you had to live with them.
Yeah, they always existed.
Yeah, there was a lot of it's funny actually, there was a lot of that stuff that went on. When you used to play Rainbow Six or even Halo sometimes, the body would sometimes stretch and it would look horrible. It was quite horrific to look at sometimes.
Yeah.
And it would stretch out their body and their arms and they'd get mangled and they'd just hover there in the middle of the level, all sort of mangled. It would look awful. And you'd go up to it and you'd look at it and you're like, look at that, look at his head. It was really gross at the same time. But yeah, that was the main thing. Do you know, the funny thing is that I can't even remember now what kind of bugs I've seen. I've seen so many different bugs, but nothing really stands out to me. There were probably ones in the past I used to test years and years ago, but muck around with. But nothing's really stood out to me in the bug sense. I think now. I
remember a couple of useful ones in Forza when you're painting cars. Mm. I don't know if you remember those ones where you could sort of put a vinyl really far away to the right hand side on the top layer and then it would start appearing like somewhere on the bonnet or I can't remember what car. It might have been like the top secret S15 on Forza 3 or something. You could move a layer all the way up to the top and right or something and it would then start appearing on like the sun strip on the windscreen and that was the way to paint your own sun strips. And if you knew someone who knew, then you found out about it and then you were able to do it. That was some fun times.
Hmm. So next question. Brian Gildy says, when is the PS4 Fanatic wheel coming out? Who knows? They haven't really spoken much about that lately, to my knowledge. I think they're still trying to sort out some sort of agreement with Sony.
Yeah, nothing's changed with the nothing's changed there. I mean, they're trying to sort something out with Sony and we'll wait and see. There is that connector though that I haven't tried. What's it called? Oh, there's a
connector or something.
No, like that. There's like I forget, someone mentioned it on one of the videos the other day actually. There's a connector that you can use to attach other wheels. I'll find out about it, come back to you guys on it. Get to do some research.
Yeah. Right, on to Twitter then. User Urso67 says, do you think GT Sport can keep up with Project Cars and Forza? We kind of covered this before, but yeah, they seriously need to catch up from what we've seen so far.
I
strongly believe that Turn 10 will blow us away as well when they announce the new Forza.
I think Forza will look incredible. I think the only thing stopping Forza is that obviously it needs a dynamic time of day and weather, and it needs a heavy refinement to the handling model. If they achieve all the three of those things, plus other improvements, then they could be the game to beat in many respects. Project Cars 2 is going to be incredible. I mean, the package is going to be immense. It's probably the game I'm going to play because I already like the handling on it in terms of what they're developing in Project Cars 2. It's already looking really good. And at the moment, GT Sport is limited, doesn't have all the features that the other games have yet. So they've got catching up to do for sure.
Yeah. So Adam McCann says, if you were to add three features in Dirt 4 and three tracks, what would it and they be? Ooh, some more stages would be a good start.
Well, I think it would just be a great increase in terms of the locations available. I think it'd be nice to have, you know, more kinds of big trucks and stuff like that, you know, multi-car racing as well as single rally racing on those stages, more like Dirt 2 in that way. I like the staggered starts in Dirt 2. I hope they have that sort of stuff happening again online. Yeah, just all round bigger. Just, I think it, at the moment, I'm just a bit concerned at the limited amount of locations, really. That's my biggest concern.
I was going to say staggered starts because rally games never seem to do that anymore.
No.
And also random hazards. If you go back to WRC Evolve, for example, you could encounter loads of different, you know, random environment hazards or other cars that have crashed off the stage. You know, it just really added to the atmosphere.
It gives it a life, doesn't it, and stuff, and that's what they need.
Just generally just more content.
I'd love to see like a story mode added, like in the Toca Race Driver, something like that. I think we're really missing that in modern racing games, and Dirt 4 would probably be quite a good candidate for something like that, but it just seems like it's a bit lacking in features.
So Fernando on Twitter says, do you guys remember, oh my god, Enthusia?
I do remember Enthusia.
Konami's one and only racing game.
Yeah, I've got it, actually. Yeah, I've got Enthusia. We will do a video at some stage. What's holding me back on PS2 games is I have a day one Japanese PlayStation 2 that plays multi-format games, multi-region games as well. The only problem is the power supply's died. And it has the most unusual power supply. So I don't know where to find the power supply to replace it. As soon as I do that, then I'll be testing all of my old PS2 titles, and Enthusia will be one of those. So we will have Enthusia action on VVV.
I'm sure I'll be very enthusiastic to see that.
Yeah, as I remember, it was quite sluggish, honestly. It took a lot of getting into. It wasn't the most dynamic racing game. A bit like, what was it? Driving Emotion Type S. Not many people know that as well, from Squaresoft when they made a racing game. And that is the weirdest racing game you'll ever play. The handling is very strange. Very strange. In fact, nobody could drive it at the time. Sorry?
Had a good cockpit camera though for the time.
It had incredible graphics. The graphics were amazing on that game. I mean, I bought it at the time, the lighting, it looked amazing. And that's why when I played it, and it played so bad, and I was like, no, the graphics are amazing. I have to make it work. And I did. I got the hang of it in the end. People said, how do you play it? How do you drive it? And I said, no, it's just got a click. There's an idea behind it. It's just an unusual approach to racing games. But yeah, I'd love to do a video on that, because not many people have seen that.
I have that game in my collection, funnily enough.
Do you? Yeah, Driving Emotion Type S. Yeah.
Yeah. I thought Enthusia actually was quite an underrated game for its time. From what I remember, it was quite a hardcore racing title.
It was a good title. It was.
Even Gran Turismo.
Where it got, there was an issue at the time. It got kind of a bit merged with another game by Namco. Namco made another Ridge Racer game of some kind that was a bit more of a realistic racing game.
R-Racing, you mean?
R-Racing, is that the one? Yeah, and they kind of got a bit confused on the market a bit, and, you know, they just kind of knocked each other out. It's just not the right time when it came out. That was the problem.
It usually came out, I think, the year of Gran Turismo 4, which was a bit of a death wish.
Yeah, exactly. You know, just no chance.
I have to say that the car selection in that game was really good for its time. It had a lot of vehicles that still don't even appear in racing games today, like, for example, the original Citroen DS. You don't see that in racing games at all.
No.
You had the new Range Rover at the time. There's another car as well. What was it? The Bugatti EB...
111.
That's the one, EB110. That's the one. Yeah, I think that was the first game I can remember to actually feature that.
Yeah.
Very odd-looking car. A bit of an underrated title, that, but Konami never made another racing game again after that. Very random. James Allen says, Is it a coincidence we're seeing so many off-road racing games as of late, or is there a particular title that's helped trigger this boom?
I don't know. I think it's cycles, isn't it? Well, it's a cycle, but it's a technology. You know, they've got the technology this generation to be able to do more. You know, and I think that, you know, we're just seeing a wider range now. I think I wouldn't say there's any one. I mean, Dirt has been successful for some years. It's not a new brand. It's not a new thing. So it's not Dirt. You know, I just think that with so many driving games on the market, there's a lot covering every genre now. You know, the forgotten genre was always open wheel racing, you know, apart from Formula One. No, I think it's a general expansion of the automotive gaming genre that we've now got. You know, everything is catered now this year. You know, with the games coming out this year, you'll be able to play WEC, you'll be able to play Formula One, you'll be able to play Rally, you'll be able to play Off-Road, you'll be able to play Rallycross, you'll be able to play everything by the end of the year. There is not going to be a driving sort of genre that you're not going to be able to play. And Off-Road is great because it can be approachable. So it's nice that we've got gravel coming this year, because that really does feel...
Is that still tickling you, Martin?
Because every time. We've got gravel coming, and that's really going to fill in that...
That's painful.
That gap, if you like. We'll just fill it in with gravel. and that's it, you know. So, you know, I think it's...
I need to ask them, why did you name it gravel?
Because dirt was taken.
Because we've done mud, so we had to do gravel.
Exactly. So, no, I don't think there's any one title. I think it's more an
increase in a number of genres. Yeah.
If anything, we would like to see more arcade racing games. I think that's the genre that's kind of like been excluded.
Outside of futuristic stuff, because there is a lot of arcade futuristic races, but just out and out arcade races, I agree that there does seem to be.
Well, like you say, I mean, you know, if we said right now, what would change things? Blur 2, okay. Split Second 2, Project Gotham Racing 5, okay. You've got three brands there that are based in the arcade world that would immediately, you know, hit the market and they'd have a fan base.
The closest we're going to get to that this year is probably Gravel, ironically.
It is.
Yeah, I like to see what Need for Speed have up their belts.
All that.
Yeah, they really need to turn things around, don't they? Need for Speed. I mean, it's.
I just want a new Hot Pursuit game, to be honest.
Yeah, I would. Yeah, it was a good game.
Okay. Yeah. So Nick Hipkin says, any news on the Art of Man TT game? Oh, we've already covered that. No. Is the answer to that. Gary Jones asks, will we be seeing any new MXGP3 gameplay soon?
Not until the end of April, as far as I'm aware. There won't be, I think it's going to be maybe even later, might be early May. We probably won't see it now. There might be a trailer, but apart from a trailer, I don't think there's going to be hands-on until they've actually completed all the tracks. So it'll be a near complete version, but if there is an opportunity to get on it, we'll be on it.
Yeah. And finally, user Basepunk asks, what made you keep returning to your favorite racing game of the past? The multi-layered multiplayer of Blur would be mine. It's for me, Driver San Francisco, because of the manic multiplayer, which is still great fun today.
For me, it was always, let's think, I suppose, there's different eras, isn't there, of gaming?
Yeah.
And I suppose, you know, not so much this era, there's nothing I'm going back to at the moment. I haven't gone back to my 360 racing games at all. But yeah, I still find I get immense enjoyment from the PS1 in terms of Wipeout and Ridge Racer. I still go back to them and enjoy them immensely. Doing these retro titles recently has been great, going back to those games. And I play them and I enjoy them so much when I'm making the videos that I think, why did I ever stop playing this game? Because they're that much fun to play, but they're simplistic. But that's it. They're just about gameplay, you know, great gameplay. And they've got that.
Could that suggest that games of this current generation won't stand the test of time as much?
I think it's fair to say that games of this generation are a lot of them are lacking. They're being rushed out the door without being completed in so many ways. I mean, we were just talking about Dirt 4. Could do with more locations. It just doesn't feel like maybe it will be brilliant when it comes out, and none of this will matter. But on paper, it just doesn't feel like there's enough.
It just doesn't feel like a finished product, does it?
No, and I think with Flat Out,
it doesn't read like a finished product.
I mean, we take Flat Out, it's the same. It needed more development. I mean, how many times have we reviewed games over the last year saying, do you know what? Another 6 months development, that game would have been great.
Yeah.
You know, and I think that's the story of the current generation is 6 months more development would have made it great. I suppose what we're talking about is where time is invested. Time is invested into perhaps the wrong places sometimes. Mm. Take Flat Out, the frame rate. I'm sorry, about it once in each video. but the frame rate in Flat Out is 30 frames and maybe as low as 20 at times.
Yes.
And I think, do you know what? You could have done away with a few textures and a bit of lighting and had maybe 30 to 60. I'd like to 60 frames, again, with removing particular details. It would have increased fluidity in the environment. That would have helped the physics. It would help the feel, the gameplay, and a polish, a professionalism. And you just don't get that in the same way. Whereas I felt years ago, things were a lot more polished. They just felt, you know, because there wasn't like patches all the time. You know, they had to complete the game and have it work before it's released.
Like we said earlier, I think there's less of that pressure now because, we can just fix it in some patches later down the line.
Yeah. I'd say that would be the year I come back. And obviously I've been playing Daytona. I still love Daytona. You know, I've been playing it today and, you know, well, before my Xbox bricked. And that was nice as well. So, love my retro racing games. If I could, actually, I really, 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 really want Sega Rally to be released because I loved Sega Rally, the original Sega Rally. Yeah. They did actually release a 60 frames per second disc with the PS2 version of the original arcade machine. And they said to everyone it was the arcade, but it wasn't. It was a version of the Dreamcast that was running. It was a version of the Sega Saturn running at 60 frames, not the actual arcade disc, which is a bummer. So we've never had a proper arcade conversion to the home apart from the Sega Saturn original.
There you have it. Right, that's it then for the Q&A, and I think also this podcast, unless anyone else has anything else to add.
No, I think that's it.
That's it then. All right, well, thanks as always for listening then. Do keep sending us in your questions for the Q&A, and we'll see you again next time. Bye for now.
Bye.
There it is.
Bye.